Timothy chapter 2, 2 Timothy chapter 2. Again, like I said, this is lesson number 15 in our first topical series, the Gospels. I plan on this being the second to the last message in this series, and then we'll switch. It won't be the next series on the list because I had received by way of email some things to add to the list. And so I'm going to split those up. So I'm going to take one from the email that I received, and then I'll take the second one on the list, and then I'll separate them like that. But I don't remember. I'll have to look at it. But this will be the second, the last message. We're going to wrap up the Gospel of God and the offshoots of the Gospel of God by reviewing what we've covered regarding the Gospel of God. The gospel, the grace of God, the gospel of Christ, and then we're going to talk about what Paul calls my gospel. And we're going to talk about that and the distinguishing difference that it has and why he calls it such. And then next week, I'll do a broad review and we'll talk about some of the other gospels, the gospel of the uncircumcision, the gospel of the circumcision, the everlasting gospel, the gospel of peace. And that's all of them. That's going to be all of them. At least all the ones that we're going to cover. Those will hit the major ones. So we'll wrap those all up in one session. And as you can therefore see, we spent most of our time looking at the gospel of the kingdom of heaven and the gospel of God. Those are the two big ones. And at least from my perspective, my understanding, the other ones kind of fall in the umbrella of those two. And obviously they have distinctions to them and why they're expressed differently with different ways of saying the gospel of. But other than that, those are two of the major ones. So hopefully this series has been some help to you in regards to looking at all the various gospels. There's a lot more that we could do, but I don't want to take much more time than we have and that we will in regards to these things. So with that being said, we're going to start here in 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm going to read verse 7 through 10. We'll pray, and then we'll get into lesson number 15 here in our series tonight. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 7 through 10. Paul says to Timothy, "Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. Therefore, I endure all things for the elect's sakes, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory." Let's pray. Father, what a grand time, what a wonderful time and a privileged time that we have, not only to be alive, not only to be your sons and daughters, having trusted Christ as our all-sufficient Savior, by believing his cross work for the debt and penalty of our sins, but being able to gather as members of the body of Christ that we are in this dispensation of grace in which we live, be able to gather together for the edification of your word. And as we look at the various gospels contained in your word, we thank you for the insight and understanding we can have in relationship to what you reveal regarding these things, so that we can have the same exact understanding that you provide us and that you have based upon your word. We thank you that we can look further into the gospel of God, specifically what Paul calls his gospel, and the nuances and the details that make it distinct. And we thank you that we've been saved by Paul's gospel, and that we can continue to be edified by Paul's gospel. So we thank you for your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for the gospel of Christ. We thank you for the new life that we have in Christ, not only by way of our standing, not only by our position, but the life that we have in regards to the wisdom of your word that we can gain in regards to your mind and be able to prove it in the details of our life, prove what is the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God, to be able to manifest you in our flesh for your honor and glory for all eternity. And we thank you that not only are we able to do that to your honor and glory, but you will reward us by rewarding us a position to reign with you in the heavenly places. May we never, never take these things for granted. We thank you for all that we have in Christ and all that you are doing through us and in us by your word and by us believing your word. It's all in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Like I said, we've been covering the gospel of God now for quite some time. And how I've presented it to you is doing it a little different than what Paul has done in the book of Romans, but take the general concept in regards to what Paul has is separated unto the gospel of God, and as he reveals it in regards to the key pieces to the puzzle, the key elements to the equation, the key ingredients to the recipe of the gospel of God, with the various individuals that God utilized throughout history to progressively reveal its content, by bringing up Adam, Abraham, Moses, David, and obviously the Lord himself, is to briefly look at the context of those things in the book of Romans themselves, and then a little bit more broader in Paul's epistles as a whole, and then go back in history and see those things historically played out, and to gain a better appreciation, again, of the content of the gospel of God and what we've covered and what Paul covers in the book of Romans and his epistles, that the issue from Adam to Moses, the issue of sin entering the world and death by sin. You have sin, death, the problem, the fall, but you also have the everlasting commandment of God's salvation in its most fundamental component form back there in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, regarding the seed of the woman bruising the head of the seed of the serpent. And therefore you have the promise of a remedy, of the solution to the problem that now had entered into the world. And the next thing is Abraham that Paul talks about in Romans chapter 4. And what's highlighted with Abraham is justification and his response in order to be justified unto eternal life and have God's righteousness accounted to be imputed unto him was a response of faith and faith alone in the message that he heard at that time. And therefore, righteousness is a key component, as well as the seed is also brought up with Abraham. So the very seed of the woman that was promised to Adam was now going to go through the seed line of Abraham. And then Moses. Moses came into play again, Adam to Moses. And with Moses, we learned the law came into play with Moses. The first time that's brought up is in Romans chapter 2. When he's brought up there by name in Romans chapter 5, it's in connection mostly with sin abounding. That with the law, sin is imputed. When there is no law, sin is not imputed. But when there is law, sin is imputed. And therefore, all the world became guilty before God. And that's what it's designed to do, is to condemn. And that's what we have. Condemnation, guilt, that's what we have in the law. And that's presented by our apostle in the book of Romans. And then David. David's brought up in Romans chapter 4. He's brought up, in fact, in Romans chapter 1 and Romans chapter 4 in two elements. And important two elements. One in connection with the... in Romans chapter 1 there, in regards to the gospel of God, he talks about the Son, that he's the gospel of God concerning his Son, Jesus Christ the Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. And what you have in connection with that is the provision that the seed of David would make in regards to his resurrection, our power to be able to redeem. And that redemption would provide the provision for God to be just and the justifier of them that believeth in Jesus, as Paul says in Romans chapter 3. But it also would provide them a relationship, a very intimate relationship. Just as the Christ, when he came, was the Son of God, we too, as we are become and we believe and we are placed in Christ, we too become sons and daughters of God. And therefore, our relationship is not based upon the law, but based upon God's grace, based upon an adult relationship, being sons. We have been adopted. And that relationship is highlighted with David. The issue of redemption, as well as the relationship, is highlighted with David. He's the son. The father is highlighted and reigning. That relationship is unto a purpose. Just like back in the old days, and still some yet today, a father would educate the son in his business and for the purpose of eventually taking over the business and running the business for the father as he grew old and eventually after he passed. the Lord Jesus Christ is going to reign. And we learned some things in connection with that in Paul's epistles, as well as the prophetic scriptures, that God is going to hand over the kingdom to the Lord Jesus Christ, who is going to subdue all things unto himself, destroy that last enemy, death. And once he has that, he'll deliver up the kingdom back to the Father, and God will be all in all, as 1 Corinthians 15 declares in connection with the resurrection. So those things are all in connection with David. In fact, when you see the issue of the kingdom, yes, that's talked about in connection with Adam. Yes, it's talked about in connection with Abraham and even with Moses. But David becomes a very significant thing. It's magnified. It's highlighted. All in the context of that relationship as father and son. And Paul talks about those things in connection with us. That by one, the Lord Jesus Christ, we are able to receive not only the gift of righteousness, but also the abundance of grace. And so that we might not just, that life might not just reign, but that we would reign in life. And the moment we believe, we have access, we possess the gift of righteousness, we have access to this grace wherein we stand, which is abundant, and we are able to take advantage of all that grace being placed under it, and therefore qualify us to, as Paul states in Romans chapter 8, to be glorified together with Christ in his reign. And then the Lord Jesus Christ himself, when he comes, he is the promised seed, and the law came by Moses, and grace and truth came by the Lord Jesus Christ, John chapter 1, grace for grace, grace and truth. The issue of that redemption that was promised, and the relationship, all that is beginning to be presented when the Lord is here on this earth. That's highlighted with the Lord Jesus Christ, and eventually, obviously, the cross work, the provision to be able to package that all together and put it in a gift and be able to deliver it. And that's Paul's due time testimony. He is the one who separated unto all these things that are highlighted and that we just briefly reviewed. He separated unto it to be able to conclude the matter, to fully reveal it, to manifest it, and to declare it. And so he has a due time testimony of all the ramifications and implications of Christ's cross work. And so that's what we've covered in regard to the gospel of God. And last week what we began to do is talk about the distinguishing factors of what Paul calls in Acts chapter 20, I believe verse 24, the gospel of the grace of God and the gospel of Christ. And what we covered in connection with that is that the gospel of the grace of God is the preaching of Jesus Christ and his gracious redemption, providing the spiritual things of the New Testament that we find according to the scriptures of the prophets. The fact that Paul is preaching that to Gentiles apart from Israel is part of the mystery, but the actual content in regards to that good news of the grace of God, in spite of the law, in spite of Israel, again, that he's doing it to the Gentiles, that's the mystery, but its content you find back in the scriptures of the prophets. And then the gospel of Christ is God's good news of his son, Jesus Christ, and his redemption, providing the spiritual things in the New Testament according to the scriptures of the prophets. Essentially the same thing, but by way of its expression, the grace of God is his son. The grace of God is Christ. It's God doing for us through his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, what we couldn't do for ourselves. So it's essentially being identified as the same thing, but yet identifying the person in whom that grace comes from. With one exception, the gospel of Christ, because of the blessing that it is to us. Quickly, come with me. Well, eventually, let me just briefly mention to you why we started here in 2 Timothy 2, is because in Romans chapter 2, Paul brings up the expression, my gospel, the first doctrinal epistle, and although 2 Timothy isn't the last doctrinal epistle, Philemon is, it's the last epistle he wrote, and both of them have contained in them that expression, my gospel, which kind of encapsulates Paul's epistles and what's set forth in it, which essentially is his gospel. When we talked about and we defined and we began to look at what a gospel is, what one of God's gospels is, whether it's the gospel of the kingdom of heaven or the gospel of God that we're looking at and its offshoots or the ones that we'll look at next week, it's not only the message that individuals had to believe at that time, but it could be a lot more news contained within it. And so the component that an individual needed to believe in order to be justified was just a part of the whole entire gospel. In other words, when you look at the gospel of the kingdom of heaven, it's the majority of its content would be what? All about what? What does its name tell us? The gospel of the what? Kingdom. The kingdom of heaven. The majority of its content is regards to the kingdom. Now you got to have a king and you got to have a whole bunch of other things, but the majority of things that when you're looking at the gospel accounts is all about the kingdom. You read the parables, the mystery parables of the kingdom, that the kingdom of heaven is like unto da 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 da. And there was this servant and they did this and they'll rule and they'll reign and this one won't the king is going to go into a far country and he's going to distribute his goods to servants and then he'll return and before he returns all this is going to happen. It's all about mostly the kingdom and what's going to transpire before he establishes it and what's going to happen once he establishes it and what that's going to be like once it is. But nevertheless, there is a component into it, in there that's part of it that they need to believe in regards to the righteousness of God is in their midst in flesh, the Son of God. And they need to believe, John 3:15, whosoever believeth that he's the only begotten Son of God, they have eternal life. And so they need to believe the Son of God. The cross isn't in the picture at that point, but that's what they need to believe in order to be justified. But that's not all the good news of the gospel. The gospel that they are believing, part of the good news is the kingdom of heaven is at what? At hand. And so the description signifies, of that gospel signifies the majority of its content. And so Paul's gospel here is not just simply the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, but it is it's the completed revelation of all the progressive revelation of its content, as we just reviewed, and also the purpose of that in this mystery period in which we live. And therefore, Paul's gospel is twofold in that it fully declares what was made known in the past, but yet wasn't packaged all together, as well as the purpose of that that wasn't made known in regards to the mystery of Christ. And that's what we find in Paul's epistles. We find those two things. And you have to realize it's twofold that way. Because if you don't, you're going to end up missing something and twisting something. I did it for years, and you can't get around it. You have to understand that, especially when you see in the Acts accounts, as we looked at last week, and maybe we'll look at a little bit again here tonight, is when, especially when he begins, and even later on in his ministry, as recorded in the book of Acts, he is preaching things out of the Old Testament. And if everything that Paul preached was a mystery, then he couldn't do that. But rather, he could take he was separated unto what was revealed before. He had the separated privilege to be able to package it all together and fully reveal that. But then he had a ministry in connection with what that fully revealed redemption and the good news of God fully revealed, what that could do. And what it could do was a mystery. It could do something apart from Israel in regards to the body of Christ, and that's not the entire issue of it, and that's where we got to get into tonight in regards to what Paul's gospel covers. So I went into that to explain why we read 2 Timothy chapter 2. Let me back up just a little bit here. In regards to the gospel of Christ, there's one caveat to the gospel of Christ in regards to my definition here for us. Again, God's good news of his Son, Jesus Christ, and his redemption, providing the spiritual things of the New Testament according to the scriptures of the prophets. The gospel of Christ is a blessing to us. Look at Romans chapter 4. Romans chapter 4. Because the good news of Christ and his redemption provides blessing. It provides eternal life. It provides the forgiveness of sins. It provides a whole host of things. It provides us to be under grace. It provides us to be sons and daughters of God. Look at Romans chapter 4, and as Paul describes that we are justified by faith alone and not by works, he goes back and talks about Abraham and David. Pick it up here in verse 5. He says, "But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness, even as David also describeth the what? Blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works, saying, Blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. Cometh this blessedness then upon the circumcision only, or upon the uncircumcision also?" There's a blessedness, and not only it being given to the Gentiles, apart from Israel, but in regards to benefiting from the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, I don't think anyone would refute that the salvation that we have in Christ is a blessing. We are a blessed people who believe that glorious gospel of our blessed God, as Paul states. Look at one other passage. Look at Galatians. Galatians chapter 4. Galatians chapter 4, and Paul is correcting them and taking them to task in regards to their foolishness to go back under the law. Galatians chapter 4, look at verse 15. It says, "Where is then the what? Blessedness he spake of?" They had benefited from God's grace and being justified and learning that they're not under law, but they're under grace and all those kind of things. But then they were beguiled, they were bewitched to go back under the law and those kind of things. And Paul comes along and says, "Don't you remember the blessedness that you spake of in regards to what they first believed and how they began," as he says there in Galatians chapter 3. And they got to remember how they begun and the blessedness that they spake of. That was a part of their conversation, those kind of things. It is a blessing. And in light of that, and the gospel of Christ being a blessing, what Paul provides in the book of Romans is only the blessing in part. Look at Romans chapter 1. Look at Romans chapter 1. So he states that he's separated under the gospel of God concerning his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And then when we get over to verse 16 of chapter 1, he brings up the gospel of Christ, which is just now focusing upon the content and the person and the work of that person, his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. But before he gets to that, he describes what this epistle is going to do. Look at Romans chapter 1 and pick up here in verse 11. He says, "For I long to see you that I may impart unto you," what? "Some spiritual gift, to the end you may be established, that is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith both of you and me." And the some spiritual gift is the blessing. It's the blessing and the description and the detail and the doctrine of the gospel of God. Look at Romans chapter 15 as he ends. Look at what he says to them. Romans chapter 15. And look at verse 29. Look at verse 28. Romans 15, verse 28. "When therefore I have performed this and have sealed to them this fruit, I will come by you into Spain. And I am sure that when I come unto you, I shall come in the fullness of the blessing of the what?" So what Paul sets forth in the book of Romans is not the fullness of the blessing. He presents to them the gospel of Christ, and he presents to them some of the blessing. The blessedness of being justified unto eternal life. The blessing of having a new identity in Christ. The blessing of having God's wisdom and being able to walk after the Spirit and a whole host of things. But he has not provided to them yet the fullness of the blessing. And the fullness of the blessing is really going to be expanded upon when he actually gets there. And when he gets there, he's going to be in prison. We know that from Acts. He's on a ship. He's being essentially transferred as a prison by way of ship to Rome. And when he gets there, he's in prison. That's where you leave in Acts 28. And when he's in prison, he writes Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians, which is where you'll find that fullness. In fact, look at that. Look at Ephesians. Look at Ephesians chapter 1. Look at verse 2. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with some spiritual gift. Blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Look at what he says later on. Look at verse 7. In whom we have redemption through his blood, there's the gospel of Christ. The forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in what? All wisdom and prudence. And he's going to make known unto them the mystery of the will. And he's going to talk about some things in regards to fullness here. Look at verse 10. That in the dispensation of the what? Fullness of times. There's so many examples here. Look at the fullness issue here. You jump down further to chapter 1. Just pick it up here in verse 21. Far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. Verse 22, and hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the what? Fullness. You begin to start looking at things in regards to fullness and all, and things that he has given to you as fullness and a whole host of things. Look at chapter 4. Look at verse 11. Look at, he says, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the what? Fullness of Christ. And that's what Ephesians is providing. Ephesians is providing the fullness of Christ. And so the blessing in part that was presented in regards to what the good news of Christ and what Christ provided there in the book of Romans, you have its fullness in Ephesians. And therefore, what you have is not only the foundation of the preaching of Christ in regards to Paul's revelation of things that were made known in the past that we now have benefited from apart from Israel, which is a mystery, but you also have the purpose of all that and the fullness of what that redemption provided is not only our justification and sanctification, but God's eternal purpose. And that's where I want to move in now in regards to Paul's gospel. Because that's where Paul's gospel really begins to distinguish itself from anything else. And like I said before, and it's very close to how Paul describes the gospel of Christ and how he explains there's blessing, there's a blessedness and there's a fullness of the blessing, is when you're dealing with Paul's gospel, what you're dealing with again is the declaration, the manifestation, the revealing of things that were partially made known before, with great detail, by the way, in the Old Testament, but that now in connection with the redemption being provided for, Paul separated unto, and he takes that thing, and he like he says in 2 Corinthians 3, he speaks with great plainness of speech. That's in a certain context, I understand that, but the way he puts it all together, the way that God utilizes it and put it all together, is a phenomenal thing that we benefit from. But not only that, Paul's gospel extends beyond that of what was made known in the past to some manner or form that now he's fully revealing to what can this really do? So again, he gets to not only reveal this in a way that was never done before, all together in its sense and sequence, and the very mind of God as he knew it before the foundation of the world, and he began to reveal it throughout history that mind that eventually would come along and present it. That's, he uses Paul to present it. But not only that, but now it's revealed, what can this do? And part of that's already known. Because what you already know is that God has a purpose with Israel. That's to establish a kingdom on this earth. But there's more that can be done with this redemption. I can form a one new man with this redemption. I can reconcile the heavenly places with this redemption. I can do something that I didn't even make known. I may have known parts of my redemption before, and Paul now has put it together, and I may have known what I was going to eventually do with Israel, but now I'm going to make known something that I never revealed before that I could do with this redemption. Do you start to see what Paul's doing here? Because you got to see that twofold manner. I know I'm a broken record, but it's important. And what Paul begins to do is he comes along and he starts to teach what God can do with this redemption that he didn't make known. And that's where you move from Acts 17 of preaching that Jesus is the Son of God and utilizing the scriptures of the prophets that the Bereans could go back and search, to Ephesians and preaching the unsearchable riches of Christ. Because he does both. It's the redemption that's in Christ Jesus that was partially made known in the past that he reveals, and then what can I do with this? And what the mystery is the mystery is not only what God can do with that redemption in regards to us as members of the body of Christ in the heavenly places, but now since that has entered the picture, what God can do with that body of Christ as well as with Israel, he can gather it together. See, before you get the revealing of the body of Christ and what God can do in formulating that one new man with that redemption, all you have is Israel. But the mystery isn't only that he has this other entity. That's part A. Part B is that now that he has this other entity that he's going to have, he can take it and he can gather it together in Christ. That's the fellowship of the mystery. And it's all based upon that redemption. He can do all of that based upon that redemption. That's simply Paul's gospel in a nutshell. And I want you to see that. So Paul's gospel is twofold. The manifesting of things that were partially made known in the past, and based upon that now full revelation of that, what God can do with that wasn't made known before. So let's look at that. Come with me. I've been utilizing these words, declared, revealed, manifested. Those are all the words that Paul uses. Conclude. Let's look at those really quick. Look at Romans chapter Romans chapter 3, and look at verse 21. Romans chapter 3, verse 21. But now the righteousness of God without the law is what? And if you remember, long ago, we talked about manifested being used in two ways, two senses. One, something that's manifest can be partially revealed, and then eventually completely revealed. I don't know if you've ever done some of those puzzles on a computer or phone or something like that, and they'll give you, one piece of the puzzle, and then you got to kind of do something to get another piece, and then, you're trying to guess what the puzzle is. And you have these pieces that manifest the puzzle, but it's not the full picture of it. And when you have that full picture, it's manifest. So manifest can be used in the sense that it can be partially made known, and then eventually it's all the way made known. Or manifest can be something wasn't made known at all, not even in its parts, and then it's eventually fully revealed. In regards to Paul's gospel, when he's talking about the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, manifested utilized in the first sense, in the first way, manner, that it was partially made known. You got Isaiah 53, which they might have not known, but it's still put in there that God's going to send his son, and his son's going to go through some sufferings for the transgressions of the people. You have the issue of the redemption focused on. I mean, Genesis chapter 3 is verse 15 is part of the gospel of God and the part of the revealing of what God's going to do through the seed of the woman, who's eventually going to be his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. So you have that. And you know that it's used that way because of what he's going to say next in verse 21. Being what? Witnessed. So the very righteousness of God without the law that Paul is now manifesting in his gospel was witnessed by the law and the prophets. So here you had the law with all of its deeds and all of its works, and one of the things it witnessed to is the necessity and the need for the righteousness of God without the very works that it demands. That's one of the things that it was designed to do. Condemn you, make you guilty, and show you that there's a need for God's righteousness apart from your works. And many people came to know that. David, Daniel, many, many individuals came to know that. They were schooled by the schoolmaster of the law, that they needed God's righteousness apart from their works that they're doing under the law. That's the blessedness that they spake of. And so what Paul's revealing here, what he's manifesting, was witnessed back there. He just gets now to manifest the full picture. Look down at verse 28. It says, therefore we, what? Conclude. Even before that, it's all in this passage, essentially, these terms. He talks about the remission of sins that are past, verse 25, through the forbearance of God, in verse 26, to declare. I say at this time his righteousness, that he might be the just and justify him which believeth in Jesus. I believe there's another declaring, verse 25, yeah, up there in the middle, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past. He makes two declarations, and you go through and you understand what a declaration is and declaring something, and you have to understand there's some finality to something that you declare, like the Declaration of Independence. There's some establishing of things that are taking place to make it the final thing that you want it to be. And again, the issue of therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith without deeds of the law. It's not that they weren't justified by the deeds of the law before, and now Paul's just saying that. He just concludes it. It's like maybe there's a question in the minds of men, not with God, in the minds of men. Paul comes along and says, that question is put to rest. No man is justified by the deeds of the law. I conclude that it's the final matter, and I'm doing that in light of the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, because that redemption is the basis in which God justified people in the past without works, knowing that he was eventually going to make it. They didn't believe it. They didn't know it. But based upon the provision of the Lord Jesus Christ, eventually, he justified them by their faith and what it was they were to believe. And Paul's concluding that. And so you have all those terms there that Paul's utilizing in connection with his gospel. Look at where the first time he uses his gospel here. Jump back to Romans chapter 2. I forgot to look up this reference, so I'm going to, if you bear with me 1 second. Yeah, get Romans chapter 2 and then get Ecclesiastes chapter 12. When Paul states for the first time the issue of according to my gospel here, there's a component of it that was made known in the past, that was witnessed to in the past, but now in connection with his gospel and in light of the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, that he states in light of all that. Look at Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and pick it up here in verse 13. He says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. Now look at what Paul is going to say in Romans chapter 2. And I'm running out of time, so I can't go in the preceding verses, but look at verse 16. It says, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men, by who? Jesus. Now that Jesus Christ has entered the picture, and in light of that redemption that he's made, and the manifestation of that, the very thing that Ecclesiastes declared, what Solomon declared back here in verse 14 of chapter 12, Paul's now coming along and picking up on, just adding to it the manifestation of God's Son, whom he's going to judge all things by, and he says, according to my gospel. He almost takes that right from Ecclesiastes. And in fact, if you go through the preceding context and the Gentiles, which have no law, have not the law, and the Jews that have the law, and the message that Solomon is preaching to the sons of men in Ecclesiastes, not just to Jews, but to all men, and their works that don't do anything for them, or their wisdom, or their thinking, it's just a vanity of vanities. It can never amount to anything, more or less justify them in the sight of God. It's all that vanity that God's going to judge. And that's a similar context to what Paul is saying here. But he says, my gospel. But here in the context, again, he has something that was partially made known, but now in light of his Son coming and being revealed and the redemption and being resurrected, the power he has to resurrect and therefore the power he also has to judge. He says, that's my gospel. Not his gospel in the sense that some of it wasn't made known before. Because Ecclesiastes tells you that God is going to judge every man's hearts and their secrets, whether it be good or whether it be bad, the very thing, same thing that Paul says. But when Paul says, my gospel, he says, God is going to judge whether you've done good or bad in the secrets of your heart by his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's my gospel. And so the distinguishing factor is just more pieces to the puzzle that Paul gets to conclude, okay?
Is that why in Romans 1:1 it mentions that one of Paul's attributes regarding his apostleship is separated? Is that the distinction? Is that he is separated from the others because he has the authority to reveal things that before were hidden?
Yep. Absolutely. Paul, I think I might express this another time, but Paul's separated from the other apostles, the 12, in regards to revealing, what God had made known in the past. And I expressed before, we went back to Luke 24, when the Lord, when he was resurrected from the dead, and he talks to those two on the road to Emmaus, and then he speaks to the 12 there, or the 11 there in the upper room, and he begins to share with them and teach them things concerning himself out of the law and the prophets and the Psalms regarding his suffering and his glory that would follow. That he does that and he shares that with them. But yet, the one who's separated to do that in regards to his full revelation, it's Paul. God is doing, that's why when we looked at over there in, 1 Corinthians 7, I don't know if that's it. You don't have to turn there, but I just got to look there. 1 Corinthians 9, when he talks about the dispensation of the gospel, the gospel that was partially made known before, that Paul's completely revealed, there's a whole, this dispensation that we live in, part of it is fully revealing that good news. I mean, think about what we know, and think about, take out Paul. Really, think about it. Just go through, get to about Acts 8, jump over to Hebrews. And there's a lot that talks about, in Hebrews, about the blood and the New Testament and those kind of things. But also think about it in the time that it was going to take place. If my understanding is correct, there's from that there 1 year time period of mercy and forbearance, there's 10 and a half years here, there's 7 years here. You got 10 and a half, 17 and a half, and a year, 18 and a half years before the kingdom's established. That has some good news about the blood that's in Christ Jesus. That God had thousands and thousands of years foretold, and he gives it 18 and a half years? No. He's going to have thousands of years of being able to share that glorious good news that he prophesied before. And he separates Paul to do it. That's what we have in this dispensation of God's grace. And not only do we have it, we don't just have it in the sense that he forgave the sins under the Old Testament. The remission of sins that are past, not just to the Old Testament from Moses forward, which is what, when you read Hebrews, that's the understanding you get. But that he took all the sin, all the remission of sins that were past through his forebearance. Go back farther, go all the way back to the beginning. That's why he brings up Adam. And so Paul has this amazing, and Paul's the blasphemer. He's the injurious one. It takes a whole different meaning and dimension to it when you understand how uniquely separated. He's not just separate in regards to the mystery. He's separated in regards to something that was partially made known. God utilizes him. And the ramifications and the implications of the power, according to the Spirit of Holiness, that the Lord is declared to have by the resurrection from the dead, Paul gets that. Paul gets to put that all together. He's the one that he can put it all together. He sees the dynamic power of that cross work in its entirety in regards to what was made known in the past, but also all that it can do. The purpose that God has for it is not just your program, Israel. It's this mystery program. I mean, you've probably heard pastors and teachers in the Grace Message say before, we can't make enough of Paul's office. When I started understanding this, we don't do enough of it. In regard, and we don't give them credit. We usually, to one extent, we almost wrongly divide the Word of God. We make Paul so separate to the content that was before that we don't give him the credit in regards to what God does with Paul in utilizing him to reveal what he was making known in the past, something that he didn't even give to the 12. That's what God gave to Paul. I mean, he took the very guy that was adamantly against his people, the injurious and the blasphemous, to even through his conduct and behavior and what Paul was doing at that time, to just even more magnify his grace. I mean, you start understanding these things and you start understanding who Paul was and what God's doing now and what he's separated unto, and the doctrine that Paul sets forth in regards to the much more love of God, you'd never question your salvation. Never. Because it's just that powerful when you start to understand it.
Got a quick question.
Yeah.
You just mentioned that Paul's declaring things that were found in the Old Testament.
Mm-hmm.
And that not even the 12 knew about. So are you saying that those things that are found in the Old Testament, that the only way Paul knew about it was because of revelation that he received? Or, I don't know, why couldn't the 12 know about it if it's in the Old Testament?
Yeah, I mean, I get. However you want to state it, whether it's revelation or, you know, it's the revelation of.
Are you convinced that the 12 didn't know, even though they didn't know the?
Well, they knew. They knew. I mean, they knew more than Daniel did, you know, because they're later on down with things. I mean, they knew that he died and they knew he was resurrected and those kind of things, but all that it did in connection with that 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 New Testament and that grace, I mean, the forgiveness of sins and those kind of things, I mean, the basic essentials that they understood in regards to their prophets, but Paul is given the putting it together. I could probably come up with a better way of describing it eventually, but it's the putting together. It's like someone coming along, and you know, I'll use the puzzle example again. You know, here's 10 pieces of the puzzle, and Peter come along and say, I know that piece, 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 all the pieces. But for some reason, I can't put this thing together.
But the actual dispensing of the grace of God, that didn't happen until the Apostle Paul.
Well,
maybe the elements were there, but the dispensing, there has to be a time frame.
Well, it's a dispensation. So it's the dispensation of grace. So the grace of God that was made known in the past, God has a dispensation in which he's dispensing it. So it's not the dispensation of the grace of God is not just it's his grace here and it's his grace here. I mean, they're going to benefit from the New Testament and the redemption that's in Christ Jesus here, and they were already starting to here. But the dispensation of it is the magnifying of it, and like I said, it's I can't put that puzzle together. And Paul comes along and says, I've been separated to do this. And so the pieces are there, but it's. And again, maybe I can come up with a better way of kind of explaining it, but you've all done a puzzle. You got the pieces, and we usually have a wonderful thing in regards to being able to see the picture to put it together. It's not like that. Paul's got the picture. Paul's the picture. Here's all the pieces that were made known, and Peter and a lot of them can know that, and they're drawn from that and they're benefiting from it and those kind of things. But Paul comes along and says, I've been separated, let me put this together. And he's got the picture to put it all together. And it's one thing when all those pieces are apart and you can, this is a rock and that's a rock. But when you see that rock and that stream on that picture, that rock has a whole different meaning when it's attached to other things. There's probably way better ways to explain it than that, but that's, you know, that's, and it could just be my understanding too.
Well-educated Pharisee, wasn't he? Paul was the rest of fishermen and tax collectors.
Yeah. Well, I don't know how much that had to do with it, because, I mean, that's God separated him unto it, so he, you know, God gave that to him, but definitely utilized what he knew in regards to the Old Testament. So I want to take the time we have remaining and begin to talk about where Paul's gospel really begins to shift from the revealing of things that were made known before in their components and their parts to its revelation and then its purpose and its mystery purpose. And that's essentially where we're at on Sundays in Romans chapter 8. Come with me to Romans chapter 8. Now, without stating the mystery here or any of those kind of things, when you're following along in the scriptures and Paul begins to talk about the creature and its deliverance, and that's what he is going to utilize us for. That's where he begins to take us being sons and daughters of God, us being children of God, us being heirs of God on the basis of the redemption that's in Christ Jesus and our faith in the cross work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he begins to describe now our purpose in light of it. And that's where he picks up here the issue of being joint heirs of Christ, verse 17. So be that suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. When he gets to verse 19, he says, for the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature is made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption to the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. Not only they, but ourselves also shall have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. The resurrection and the redemption of our body is nothing new. The Sadducees were against any resurrection, and especially a bodily resurrection, but that's what many believed, is a bodily resurrection, especially after Christ rose from the dead. That's all made known. But what are we going to use our redeemed body for? Where? That wasn't made known. And for what purpose? And that's what Paul begins to present here. It's in connection with the creature. And he doesn't come along and state the mystery yet, but he's going to do that in the next couple chapters. You know probably the chapter, if you look at Romans chapter 11. Romans chapter 11, look at verse 25. Which, by the way, having this understanding of things that are made known and then the difference helps you understanding was oftentimes confused regarding the olive tree and those kind of things and being grafted in. Romans chapter 11. But look at verse 25. It says, "For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel, until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in." And that's what's going to happen. Israel's the blind in part, and God's doing something with the Gentiles, Jew and Gentiles. And once that fullness is had and be come in, he's going to utilize us to deliver the creature from the bondage of corruption and utilize us for his purpose that he has in the heavenly places. And it's part of the mystery. The mystery is Israel's state, what God's doing with the Gentiles while Israel's in that state, and what God's doing with the Gentiles while Israel's in that state for the purpose. And the purpose, he's already stated in Romans chapter 8. And you have now a combination of these things that is going to come very influential as you proceed further. On your way over to Ephesians, look at Romans chapter 16. Also, understanding this, that Paul is given the separated privilege to reveal things that were made known in the past, as well as to declare things that weren't made known in regards to the purpose of that redemption. He ends by saying this, Romans 16, verse 25, "Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel," that's what's contained here in the book of Romans, he's going to utilize it to establish them, and now he's going forward to establish them. He's got more things to talk about. That's what he's told them in chapter 15, verse 29, that when he comes, he's going to bring the fullness of the blessing of the gospel of Christ. But he says, "According to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest, and by the what? Scriptures of the who? Prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. To God only wise be glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen." All those things he is going to utilize to establish you. It's one of those things where, well, at least for me, knowing the study to coming to this understanding as I've been expressing it, hearing someone say that this is of no value and no profit, that's not what your apostle says. Your apostle says that he's going to utilize the scriptures of the prophets to establish you. You don't know Paul's gospel if you don't know those scriptures. And that's why we don't just have Romans through Philemon as a Bible. We have Genesis through the Revelation. Because we need all of it. if we want to have the mind of God concerning all of his things, both the searchable things and the unsearchable things, which is Paul's ministry, then we need all of it. And there are things we need to rightly divide, and there's things that we need to see Paul's role in, and there's things that we don't need to rightly divide because they're similar that we can learn from, that we can gain great benefit and profit out of. There's things that we keep absolutely separate, but we need all of it. We just got to handle it properly as we deal with it, as Paul deals with it. Well, come over with me now, in the last couple minutes I have remaining, to Ephesians. When Paul is at Rome and he writes this prison letter, Ephesians, he's there at Rome. He can be ministering to the saints at Rome this fullness, the very content that he's writing to the saints at Ephesus, the content he's writing to the saints at Philippi, and the content that he's writing to the saints at Colossae. And you find that fullness of the blessing here. And again, I want you to note the fullness of the blessing is twofold. It's in regards to God's plan with us, but also in light of what God can fulfill with us, what he'll finally conclude. Pick it up in Ephesians chapter 1. And look at verse 7. Look at this now. In light of all that we talked about, here it is, verse 7. Whom we have redemption through his blood. Those things are made known. Paul gets to reveal those things. It's not that they didn't have understanding. We just got done talking about that. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Wherein, the riches of his grace, he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. Now based upon that redemption, and based upon the manifestation of his grace in regards to his redemption, especially redeeming us and forgiving our sins and what he's doing with us today, now he can give all the wisdom. Because before, you didn't even have the full picture of the redemption. And even if you had the full picture of redemption, you had it in light of God's program with Israel. And therefore, you only have God's wisdom in part. But we're given all wisdom and prudence. Verse 9, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. That's what he made time for. He made time to be able to do some things in earth, do some things in heaven, and have it gathered together. And so the mystery is not only what God can do with us in the heavenly places, but now in light of what God's going to be doing with us in heavenly places, what he can do in gathering them both together in Christ. All based upon that redemption. And when Paul writes those letters, he's providing the fullness of the blessing of that gospel of Christ. That when it was first made known, it was just made known in regards to it, things that were made known in the past, but that are now revealed by Paul. And now Paul's going to come along and say, look at what that can do in regards to us, delivering the creature from the bondage of corruption, but now in light, oh, the unsearchable riches of Christ, how he can gather it together. There ain't nothing. There ain't nothing like this stuff. There's nothing like it. This is what Paul eventually calls. Look at Ephesians chapter 3. By the way, this is what he talks about when he's in Ephesians chapter 2. Notice it's the fullness of times. That's why my understanding, some people say that the dispensation of fullness of time is going to happen right after the rapture. You have to have the reconciled state of both heaven and earth before he gathers it together. He doesn't have an unreconciled state on the earth and the dispensation of fullness time is not the process of gathering it together. He's going to reconcile the heavenly places first. That's the mystery of iniquity, what God's doing with iniquity and how he has his one man and how he's going to manifest and glorify his one new man before the adversary can glorify his man. He's going to have that and he's going to get the heavenly places back because that's the very first realm that the adversary took back. That's what 2 Thessalonians is teaching. And then he's going to reconcile the earth back. And once he has that, and he deals with that judgment and that last enemy, that's the fullness of times. Because you still got time here. Here, sorry. How much time you got right here? 1,000 years. That's not the fullness of time. Fullness of time is it's full. It's matured to the point where God wanted to utilize it for, and now he's going to gather it all together in Christ. It's out here.
It's the fruition.
Yeah, it's the fruition of all that he's done. Look at, and that's what he's talking about in Ephesians 2. He first, in verses 1 through 10, talks about the redemption that we have and the workmanship that we are in Christ. And then he goes and starts talking about time. Time past, but now. He talks about ages to come. And he does that, and he says this. Look at verse 19. He says, "Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord." That's what he's talking about. All the building out here, heaven and earth. Israel on the earth, and us in the body of Christ in the heaven. And then he narrows it down to us, verse 22, in whom you also are builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit. And then he goes to chapter 3, "For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ for you Gentiles, if you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God which is given me to you word, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, whereby when you read you may understand my knowledge and the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men, as is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit." He just got done saying that we're built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Now he comes along and says there's some things that weren't made known before, as they're now revealed to his holy apostles and prophets. That same issue of things that were made known and then things that are not made known. He's eventually going to say this. Look at verse 6. Jump down to verse 8. He says, "Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the searchable riches of Christ." Unsearchable. "And to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery." What God's doing in the mystery and how it fellowships with what he's going to do in regards to the earth. That's what Ephesians is all about. He sets the tone in Ephesians 1. I got the gathering together in view. And you see it in chapter 2. You see it in chapter 3. You have our vocation in chapter 4 and how we're supposed to walk in light of all that. He even talks about it a little bit in chapter 5, the great mystery. But then he goes on, verse 9, "And to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery which from the beginning of the world hath been hidden God, who created all things by Jesus Christ." He created the heaven and earth. All things by him and for him, and by him all things consist. Colossians chapter 1 talks about. And so that's what he's going to do. He's going to gather it all together. And this is what he's going to call it. He says, "To the intent that now unto the principalities and powers and heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God." The manifold wisdom of God. "According to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord." It's the eternal purpose. You want to know what the eternal purpose is? The eternal purpose is the gathering of heaven and earth in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we get to be to the praise of his glory in the heavenly places, and Israel to the praise of his glory here on earth. The fellowship of the mystery is how all that comes together. Well, that's Paul's gospel. There's a lot more. There's all the details that fit into that structure. But those are the two main things. When you're in Romans, the blessing in part and the making known of the spiritual things of the old, that were in the scripture of the prophets in regards to the New Testament and how we get them apart from Israel, that's part of the mystery. And also the mystery in regards to not only Israel's state, but in light of Israel's state, what God's doing with us now, in regards to us being the new creature, to deliver the creature from the bondage of corruption. And the mystery of Christ and the fellowship of the mystery is how he's going to gather it all together. The prophecy of Christ is the issue of the earth. The mystery of Christ is not only what God's going to do in heaven, but the gathering of all of it together in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'll end on this. That's just the beginning of eternity. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time to get into your word, to look at Paul's gospel and how unique it is in both his separated role to manifest things that were made known in the past, the unique privilege that he had, but also the special privilege and the peculiar privilege that he had to set forth all that that redemption provided for in regards to your eternal purpose. A large part of it not being even made known in time past. Not even being made known from the foundation of the world or beginning of the world, but was hidden in you, that you now revealed through the Apostle Paul in regards to not only us being members of the body of Christ to reconcile the heavenly places, but with your ability to do that, how you can gather to heaven and earth in your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, we thank you that not only that will take place in the time to come, but as Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 7, that in the ages to come, you might show the exceeding riches of your grace and your kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. The words that are utilized to describe what is only what we don't even know. For even the fullness of the blessing that we receive in Ephesians is just a measure. It's the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. It's a measure of it. And therefore, what you will show us and how Paul can only write it is with a whole bunch of adjectives describing your grace. And that you're going to show the exceeding riches of your grace and your kindness toward us. As if you sending your Son to die on the cross to pay for the debt and penalty of our sins wasn't enough. As if us living in this dispensation of your grace wasn't enough. As if being able to learn you, Father, isn't enough. As if not only having the chance to reign with you in the heavenly places isn't enough. You have more for us. What a privilege to be your sons and your daughters. May we never take it for granted, and may we let these things enliven our inner man, have us awake out of sleep, and cast off things that this world has that are just vain, that we get wrapped up in, that have no real use or purpose, and set our affection on things above, to lay hold on eternal life. For it is that which you have called us unto. We give you the thanks and praise for your word, for your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and his cross work. As always, we pray if someone's here listening, if they have not believed that Christ died for their sins, was buried, and rose again, that they would do that this very moment. In the very moment they do, they'll receive the forgiveness of all their sins, past, present, and future, your righteousness imputed unto them, and they'll possess the gift of eternal life, and oh, so much more. If they so choose and are willing to learn what you have for them, truly their life will have purpose, value, and they will be on a course that you've predestined that is filled with spiritual profit, not only now, but for the life that is to come. May they not receive, if they do so receive the grace of God and are justified, may they not receive it in vain, and utilize their justification unto eternal life for no purpose, but for the purpose that you have set forth, and to be to the praise and honor of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, by walking worthy of the kingdom in which you have for us in the heavenly places. We give you all the thanks and praise, and for this time of grace giving, in Christ's name, amen.